Yeah, alhamdulillah, salatu wasalam ala Rasulillah Ramadan. So as the month of Ramadan is coming.
Sir, the questions can be asked later because we will cover the.
Yes. Let's see if it's very important, then you can ask. If it's not that important, then do not ask. So the word Ramadan, is derived from the word Ramadan. Ramadan means heat. So when the desert, when you are in desert, you know, at the Nisfun Nahar, at the middle day, midday, you know, when the sand is really hot, the word is called Ramadan. So the word is Ramadan. That is, Ramadan is the time of hardship. You know, for example, this year it's going to be 17 hour long. So the whole purpose of Ramadan is to take in hardship. Right? So as we discussed in Sahari and all that, excessive amount of eating, excessive amount of drinking at the time of Sahari, then you keep on burping till Maghrib and you don't feel hunger. So that is against the concept of Ramadan. So to take hardship, that is the whole purpose of take hardship and do some. Don't complain. That's why to complain that bhai aaj roza bahut lag raha hai. Today brother it's very tough. Oh my god, I'm feeling hungry. That is against. So do not. So Ramadan means by itself means hardship. It should be hot. Okay, in America, mashallah, so much comfortable life with AC and everything. It's not that hot. Anyhow. Now there are two purposes for Ramadan as mentioned by our scholars. One is to purify your body and soul, right? And the second is to get forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now after Ramadan you should be in a condition that inshallah you are a clean person. What you were on the 30th of Shaban, now on the 30th of Ramadan, you are a clean person. Your soul and your body is clean. Your ruh is clean. Right? Plus you have sought forgiveness. So that is. So inshallah we'll start with the few hadith. Now, I'm not willing to read this month. But the month of Ramadan is around, we are happy to present information on Ramadan. Okay, so the whole purpose of this class is that you could welcome Ramadan, right, in the right frame of mind. Right frame of mind means that you have a clear concept of what Ramadan is all about. Now, why it is important to prepare for Ramadan? Number one, it is the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Like I told you in Jummah of Khutbah that our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam always used to prepare Sahaba before the start of Ramadan. He will assemble them and he will tell them that, you know, in few days the month of Ramadan is coming, and you know, Rasulullah will talk about the fazail of Ramadan, how mutabarrak that month is, and how, what are the virtues, what should you do, what should not do, about Quran, how important Quran is, how much you read. So to talk about Quran, like, you know, last night we had a gathering with all the everything, all the talk about centered around Quran. So that is the sunnah, that, you know, you should prepare yourself. So this gathering and other gatherings in different parts of the world that are taking place before Ramadan is actually an effort to follow on the footsteps of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That you do not take it for granted, ke bhai, you know, Ramadan, okay, we'll fast. Without understanding the concept, without preparing mentally for that. So that is a cultural, that will be a cultural Ramadan. You know. So no, we have to have shu'ur. We should have proper iman, what the maqsad of Ramadan is. Okay. Now the month of Ramadan is the ninth month of the Islamic calendar. Okay? So this is the month. So it comes after Sha'ban, before Shawwal, right? The Shawwal and the Dhi Qa'dah and the Dhi Hijjah, then the new month starts. Now, what are the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had prohibited upon us to do? One is that from the time of Fajr till Maghrib, we cannot eat, we cannot drink, and we cannot have any sexual activity. So these three things are completely haram in the fasting hours. And we'll talk about this in detail later. Now, people who are exempted from fasting. Now, all the minors are exempted. Who is the minor? That person who had not reached the age of puberty. For girls and boys both. Right? Now for boys, remember brother, in ilm there is no haya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna Allah la yastahi bil haq. When you are seeking ilm, you should not feel shy. So for boys, it is wet dreams. When they see the first wet dream, now they are baligh. They have reached the age of puberty. Now, salah is fall upon them. Fasting is fall. Now they are adult. They can even lead salah. Minors cannot lead salah. Even if he is a hafiz of Quran, he cannot lead salah. He has, because why? Because salah is not obligatory upon him yet. So how can he lead people? Now people are adults. It's obligatory upon them, and here is a kid who, you know, and the salah is not obligatory upon him, how can he leave? But once he sees the first wet dream in his lifetime, whether it's 11, 12, 13, 14, whatever it is, that person is baligh, or he has reached the age of puberty. Now salah becomes fard upon him. Now he is a hafiz, he can read the salah of Tarabi, he can read first salah and everything. Similarly, fasting becomes obligatory upon him. Now he is baligh. Right? And for girls, once they have the first circle, they are in the state of puberty. Now all the ahkamat that has to do with Muslims are applicable upon them. So the first thing is that those children who are still minors, they are exempt. Second, people who are exempt are aged people. Now, who are the aged people? Aged people are those people who are so old that they cannot fast. The doctors tell them that, you know, you cannot fast. You know, now there are some people who are old and they still fast. They still fast. My dad was fasting till he was 80 years old. 80 years old, still used to fast. Yet in the last year or two, he stopped. So there are some old people who are better than young people. So age means that, you know, if you are too old and the doctors tell you that no, sir, you cannot fast now. So as I was telling you after Fajr Salah class, that now those people have to give fidya. Fidya is feeding one person, one miskin. Okay.
Per day. He doesn't have to be a fasting person, it could be any person.
So fidya is to feed a miskeen, a poor person, and in our country, US, it's around roughly around $7. Yes, yes, $7. So now remember fidya, let me repeat one more time before I go ahead. Fidya is upon that person or person who cannot fast anymore in their life. If somebody is a sugar patient, you know, somebody old and all this. So now they have to give fidya. Now sick. Sick is that person who is temporarily sick, not permanently sick. If they are permanently sick, then they have to give fidya for every missed day of fasting. Sick person is that who is right now exempted. But this exemption is not for good. Once he recovers, he's a normal person. He's a, mashallah, person with good health.
Can we give money to non-Muslims?
Fidya, no. Fidya and zakat and sadaqatul fitr, these are three things that cannot be given to non-Muslims. General Charity, yes. Like we feed Alhamdulillah poor people. So we, when we go to downtown to feed inshallah Alhamdulillah, so we feed people of all faith. That is sadaqah. That is like general donation. But fidya, sadaqah, al-fitr, and zakah. These are three things that have to be given to Muslims. If you give zakat to a non-Muslim, that is not acceptable. So sick person who is exempt, but his exemption is temporary. Once he recovers, he has to do qada. Now a sick person cannot give fidya if his sickness is temporary. He cannot give fidya. He has to do qada. That is wali upon him, once he recovers. Okay, third is traveler. Now, what is the minimum distance that you travel that will make you a traveler?
46 miles.
Yeah. Is this 40? 48, 46 miles, whatever it is. Something 46. So the thing is that, let's keep it 40, 48. For 48, if you travel for 48 miles, then you are a traveler. But that traveling has to be out of your city. Let's say if you went to downtown, came back, went to for shopping, came back, and you look at your now, I travel 50 miles, I'm a musafir. Then, what, that one, musafir means you leave the, let's say you go from here to Tampa. That is what, 70 odd miles? You are a musafir. So if you are musafir, you are exempt from fasting, but remember you have to do qada of that.
You have to do it anyways.
Yeah, so you have to. Pregnant women, they have to do qada after they deliver their baby and then they are in sihat. They have regained their health, they feel that they can fast, now they have to fast. So pregnant mothers, they have to do qada of that. If a mother is breastfeeding the baby, she's exempt. Why is she exempt? Because she needs to take care of her health plus the health of the baby. So now she should not fast. If she will fast, she's putting her life and the life of the child in danger. But she has to make up. So she has to make up, inshallah, after she... After now the a woman who is in a monthly cycle during those days, she is exempt, but she has to fast right after eid as soon as possible. And that was telling you after Fajr class that in qada delay is not good. Just like if you for example, if you did not woke up for Fajr today, right? Now you have to pray qada. The sunnah is to pray qada right after you wake up. So usko ye mat karein ki bhai, you know, I'll pray later on, you know, 3 hours, 4 hours down the road. No. Do it right away. Similarly, in all of these conditions where qada is wajib, you have to do it right away, as soon as possible. In this regard, in, you know, Shawwal, the 6 days of Shawwal, right? If you have some qada over you, so first you have to do qada first, because that is mandatory. So you will do things which are mandatory upon you first, right? Then 6 days of Shawwal are sunnah. If you do, you will get reward. If you don't do, there is no punishment for that. So things which are mandatory, do that first. Mentally impaired. So mentally impaired, you know, is also a person who is exempt from fasting. Yes, if in future he regains his senses, he became a healthy person, he'll start fasting. But during the time he was mentally impaired, he's exempt. Yes,
sir.
Fidya
for the mentally
impaired. Fidya. Jo bhi hai, fidya for the parent. Remember the principle. If the sickness is permanent, right, that's fidya. Because there's no hope of qada. Second is sickness or suffer or whatever, or a mother's issue. So these are temporary. For temporary, that is permanent. These are.
Immediately means even the sun rising, or we have to wait?
No. It is understood already. If you did not get up for Fajr and the sun is rising when you got up, you have to wait till the sun is out completely and then pray the qada of Fajr.
If you suppose you're fasting, you're planning on going to Tampa, but you feel like you can fast, it's okay.
Yeah, it will come. Allah said, "Wa antasumu khayrul lakum." If you are traveling or you are sick, but you feel that you can fast, Allah said, to fast is better than not fasting. But remember, do not hurt yourself in doing so. Allah doesn't want you to hurt yourself. So this is the ayah of Quran which we talked about after Fajr, and I think you all know that Allah Subhanahu explained all these rules in the ayah. And now, what is the goal of the fast? Brothers, this is the most important thing. And we have to center our attention here. What is the goal of fasting? Brothers and sisters, the goal of the fasting is that you achieve taqwa. Taqwa means self-restraint. That is what taqwa is. Self-restraint. You should inculcate this power within you, that you will restrain yourself from doing everything that could anger Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. If you can develop this, that is good. Right? That is taqwa. Do not do anything which would make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala angry at you. Now I'll give you a few examples quickly for you to understand. And I give this example all the time. If you have heard this from me before, it will be a review. Let's say you came home fasting, Ramadan. 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the afternoon, nobody home. You are extremely hungry, extremely thirsty. Nobody home. Nobody is watching over you. You came home and you saw that you opened your fridge is loaded with food and drinks, all kind of drinks. Now, if you have taqwa, you will close the fridge, you will not eat anything. Question is, why did you do this when nobody is watching over you? Allah is watching over you. But this is taqwa. This taqwa. That you are feeling that nobody is watching over me, but Allah is still watching over me. Brothers and sisters, this is taqwa. But is he to expand earlier? Expand upon this? That each time you do anything wrong, where is that feeling now? That Allah is watching you. So this self-restraint is that when you open that fridge, you self-restrain. That no, I cannot do this. Although the food is all halal. And cut chicken. all like juices and all that. But still you close it. No. So you are not indulging into something which is generally halal, eating and drinking. So what about haram then? How can you indulge into haram? So in Ramadan, Allah is training us that during the fasting hours, if you can restrain yourself from halal, then in the other months of the year, it should be easy for you to restrain yourself from haram. So this is why, brothers and sisters, the whole purpose is لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Perhaps you will inculcate this sifat, this quality of self-restraining, taqwa. Now there are many definitions of taqwa. Of course, we can keep on talking about taqwa for a long time. But all the the other definitions are explanations. You know, for example, I can give you one that I'm thinking of right, in the top of my head right now, that Umar, when he was Khalifa, I think it's Sahaba, but they were amazing people. Umar is a Khalifa. He knew what Rasulullah said about him. Who can tell me? That's why I was telling one hadith regarding the fadilat of Umar. We don't have time to go into it.
One is that when Shaitan sees him,
he changes the path. When Shaitan sees Umar is walking on the path, Rasulullah said he fears Shaitan sees Umar too much, then he changes the path. He goes on the, and Rasulullah said that if there was a Nabi to come after me to have a minute, there are so many fadilat of Umar radiallahu anhu. But Umar, regarding the Sabuf class yesterday, I was telling you again that you, the more you are closer to Allah, the more you should be humble. Or in, to put it the other way, you cannot get close to Allah until you humble yourself. And humbleness means that you consider yourself that you are the biggest criminal in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This person is a lot better Muslim than I. Even a person who is drinking, even a person who is committing zina, you should think that I am worse than him. Because maybe this person has a good quality and Allah would forgive him. But the moment you start thinking that, no, I am the best here, I am the best Muslim, all of these guys are inferior to me, you can never get close to Allah. Anyhow, so Umar was, so he's a Khalifa, and one day he says to Ubay ibn Ka'b. Who was Ubay ibn Ka'b? He was a very, he's the best Qali of this Ummah. Rasulullah said the Qiraat of Ubay is awesome. Allah sent salam to Ubay, to Jibreel. And Ubay and Rasulullah will do a door of Quran during the night of Ramadan. Ubay was Katibul Wahi as well. And all the fifth. So one day Umar asked Ubay, Ubay, tell me what is taqwa? How would you define taqwa? So Ubay asked that, oh Umar, you know that. Why are you asking me? He said, no, I want to learn from you. So Ubay, he said, okay. He said, oh Amir al-Mu'min, have you ever went to a forest? Yeah. He said, if there are thorns everywhere, and you have to pass between the thorns, how would you pass? He said that, you know, I will make sure that I pass between those, that path in a way that no thorn can inflict me. So first Umar said that this is taqwa, that you live in this world in a way that the love and the temptation of this world doesn't come in my heart. Bas musafir ki tarah. See, this is taqwa. So the definition of the in English it says self-restraint. So that is the purpose of taqwa. So on the 30th of Ramadan or the 29th of Ramadan, whatever the case is, you should have that sifat of self-restraint in you, then alhamdulillah your Ramadan is accepted.
Self-restraint in religion should be self-restraint because of Allah.
Because? For the sake of
Allah. Anybody can do self-restraint.
Yeah, for the sake of Allah.
Just for the sake of Allah.
So the taqwa is, again, there are different definitions. You can, inshallah, we'll forward this to you so you can read it. Now, the second thing is about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that his sunnah was that he would address Sahaba on the eve of Ramadan. Right? So let's cover that hadith that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said during the last day of Sha'ban. Rasulullah said, people, a great and a blessed month has come to you. So this means that now we can say Ramadan Mubarak to each other. Why? Because Rasulullah is saying that Shahrun Mubarak, a blessed month has come to you. So when we WhatsApp each other, you know, Ramadan Mubarak, so that is fine. You know, that is according to the Sunnah. Allah has made fasting during it an obligation, and steadfastly observing its night's worship a voluntary act. So to fast is farz, to pray salat taraweeh is sunnah muakkada. So whoever undertakes an act of obedience, meaning when you do a farz act during this month, then it Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm sorry. So when you do a nafil act, right? In this month Allah gives you the reward of a farz act. And when you do a farz act in this month, Allah gives you the reward of 70 farz acts in this month. So every good act that you do, the reward is multiplied. It is the month of patience, and the reward of patience is paradise. Patience from eating, from drinking, from other activities. And the reward for that is Jannah. Okay. Now here is Ramadan timetable. What does fasting involve? Okay. Now brothers and sisters, here you see that during the daytime, all you have to do is you have to refrain from eating, drinking, and sexual activities. Okay? So these are the things that you have to do in Ramadan. Of course, this includes salah and all that. Right? But during the night, right, there are many things that you have to do. The nights of Ramadan are loaded, are very busy. Right? During the day, what you have to do? Alhamdulillah, we pray five times salah, right? So, but additionally, we don't have to eat, drink, or do sexual activity. That's the addition. But during the night, right, apart from praying Maghrib and Isha, there are other things that we have to do. And that is eating before dawn. I mean, none of us do that outside Ramadan. Right? We have nashta or breakfast after. But in Ramadan, you have to do that nashta before dawn. So that is an initial thing. Special prayer, tahajjud, and tahajjud, that eating, drinking, and sexual activities are permitted during the night of Ramadan. Then again, special prayer, which is Salat Taraweeh, and then, of course, after Maghrib, breaking the fast. So these are the additional things that we do only in Ramadan. Okay? This is breaking the fast, yes, earlier. This is Salat Taraweeh. Okay? Then bringing then special with tahajjud, and this is eating before dawn. That is Sahri Shuru. These are the things that are additional in the month of Ramadan. Now, an important part of Ramadan is that is how can we keep ourselves away from sin? This is very important. Because if you are sinning along with fasting, they do not go together. They do not go together. So here's the hadith. Rasulullah said, Allah has just underline it. Allah has no need. Allah doesn't want your fasting. So Allah has no need for the hunger and the thirst of the person who does not restrain from telling lies and acting on them, even while observing fast. Meaning when you are observing fast and you are lying, for example, and lying is just one among the many haram things that a person can do. So Allah is in no need of your fasting if you are not ready to forsake lying. When one of you is fasting, he should abstain from indecent acts and unnecessary talk. And this is good. This is applicable for men, women, both. Unnecessary talk, no gossiping, no, you know, this is a month where you should avoid all this. And if someone begins an obscene conversation, fohish baatein, or tries to pick an argument, you should simply say, brother, I'm fasting. You should know. You know, just tell him very politely, brother, I'm fasting. Or sister, I'm fasting, whatever the case. But if you indulge into any obscenity, vulgarity, or indecent talk, or even if you are just gossiping, excessive talking, these are all sinful activities in this month of Ramadan. So like Maulana Thanvi Sahib Rahimullah said beautifully in one sentence, he said, in Ramadan, do three things. eat less. Eat less, talk less, sleep less, and your Ramadan will be good. So eat less, sleep less, and talk less. If you do three things, your Ramadan would be, inshallah, good. Like, you know, why do we sit down and talk about politics? You know, he did this, he did that, Nawaz Sharif ne kiya, Bush did this, and Obama did this, forget about all that. And when you go to the star parties, you know, they sit down, you know, all that, so just avoid all this. Talk only what is necessary. Yes.
Well, I know when I'm doing Ramadan, I have to do appreciate, like if I have a day off from work, I do take a nap or something once in a while.
Oh, that's
you know, in between my prayers.
Oh, yes, yes, that's fine. But what one scholar said is that, you know, sometimes, and this is in our culture, by the way, like if you go to Saudi Arabia, right, they just from Fajr, and it's a culture, from you guys know that most of the Saudis, they sleep during the day. During the night, they're up. But during the day, so it should be they're defeating the purpose of fasting.
Okay.
Fasting, no, you do your normal routine. You go to job, you do your stuff, whatever you do, right? That's when you feel the
Holy Spirit.
Yeah, the holiness in you, right? And yes, sleep, but do not just keep on sleeping. That you are, that you slept like
no,
17
no.
hours. Yeah.
These odd cat naps. I also exercise. You know, I tend to go running
yes.
or something.
Exactly. People go to gym. And one youngster I saw last year, yeah, he was jogging after Asr, and he was running on a popular mile, and he was fasting. I asked him if I said yes. I said, well, he was young, 16, 17 years old.
Something can talk about cricket.
So
it less means more ibadah.
Yes.
Thanks very much.
So if the whole purpose is do not sleep excessively. You should feel hardship. And again, when it says vulgarity, brothers and sisters, please okay, listen, except a few, but I have to say this. That please keep yourself away from social media as much as possible. And one Ramadan I have planned to talk about one Juma just on social media. The good thing and the bad thing of social media is very important. So because I was telling you that the every divorce that is taking place in our community, social media is playing a big role in splitting the families, the splitting of families. So we need to know, because it's a new thing, we do not know how to use it. So let's see what Allah would say. So during this month of Ramadan, don't waste your time on social media, on Facebook, looking into other people's life, what they are doing, what they are eating, what they are wearing, where they are vacationing, and this and that. And please, you know, films and music and all that stuff. If you are indulging in all this, then you are defeating the purpose of fasting. So here Rasulullah said, you have to keep yourself away from indecent acts, unnecessary talks, and every obscene act. And watching films, whether it is Bollywood or Hollywood, whatever it is, it's all obscene. Most of them are vulgar. And you are fasting, it defeats the purpose. So that was the hadith of Rasulullah. Now, annual training for character building, this is so important, brothers and sisters, that Ramadan is like a battery that is charged, right? And that battery of spirituality that is charged in the month of Ramadan should be so strongly charged that this should remain with you for the next 11 months. So it is like a spiritual springtime. Your battery is being charged. So Ramadan provides an annual training opportunity that is meant to fulfill that character building need for the rest of the year. Now, different ulama have defined taqwa in different ways. They have used different words for this. And all of those words are, alhamdulillah, correct, and all of them fall in the same category. So for example, taqwa is God fearing nature, afterlife accountability, patience, self-control, self-discipline, responsibility, obedience, and purification of soul. All of these are part of taqwa, right? So the whole thing is that we need to understand and implement it. Now, the month of Ramadan, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had divided this month into three parts. The first 10 days are called the days of Rahmah, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows special Rahmah in the first 10 days. The next 10 days are the days of Maghfirah. Allah just loves to forgive people. And the last one is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would set the fasting people free from hellfire, inshallah. So these are the three ways Rasulullah sallallahu divided this month. Okay, so let me repeat what I said to you in Juma. It's very important, and after Fajr class also I repeated it. But for those brothers and sisters who just came, let me repeat that if you combine the ahadith of Rasulullah on this topic, we come to the conclusion that everybody, inshallah, will be forgiven in this month of Ramadan, except for four kinds of people. These four kinds of people will not be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even in this month. First is the person who is addicted to drinking al-khamr. Sharabi, if he is not making tawbah from sharab, from liquor, and he is saying, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forgive me and this and that, Allah says, no. First, why? Because al-khamr is, hijab is what? Ummul Khabais is the mother of all evil, Rasulullah said. So you are indulging into something which is Ummul Khabais, the mother of all evil, and still you want to forget it. Allah said, no. Rasulullah said, of course you have to stop indulging into Ummul Khabais. That one. Second one is? Disobedient child. Nafarman Allah. So if either person is bad to his parents or her parents, right? The parent's heart is broken and this person is fasting, doing itikaf and does this and that. But when it comes to parents, he just is bad. No matter how much ibadah this person does, it is not accepted by Allah. First, he has to start being nice to his parents and then Allah will accept. And this becomes more severe if your parents have died and they left this world with a heavy heart. They were very mad at you. You broke their heart. Now they are gone. Now you are fasting and saying, Allah forgive me, Allah forgive me, make my children good Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, none of that. I will not accept. You were bad and your mom and dad died and they were mad at you. Well, Rasulullah did say, now if you want to repent, the doors are still open. You do sadaqah on behalf of your parents. You do some good deeds, sadaqah jariyah, inshallah Allah could forgive them. The doors are open all the time. But it is very bad if a person is bad. Third is that if a person is
break up relationship.
Yeah, he is with his relatives, he is very mean. Very mean. He breaks the family. And he himself is bad to his or her relative, that is not accepted. That person's ibadah is not accepted. And the third is? The fourth is a person who keeps hatred, kina parwar. A person who keeps hatred in his heart. His heart is never clean about people. He gossips, he does backbiting, slander. He never thinks good about others. So that person is? So these four categories of people, according to several ahadiths, these people will not be forgiven. And remember, I told you earlier that this has to do with muamala, your dealing. So my dear brothers and sisters, most important thing in Islam is that your dealing should be right. Salat, zakat, hajj, sawm are important. But more important than that is your dealing with people. If your dealing is right, then salah is, and psalm is going to be accepted by Allah. If your dealing is wrong, nothing is going to be accepted. Nothing. So the most important thing is you learn and make sure that your dealing with people is right. That is practical. Ek baat kya bata hai? You know, Allama Iqbal? So one time, you know, when Allama Iqbal came from England, barrister, and his practice was flourishing in Lahore. So there was one person who was, he had a long beard. He used to pray five times salah and all that stuff. He used to come in the morning, in the evening, and used to sit with Allama Iqbal. So he became his good friend. But he used to taunt Allama Iqbal, rahimahullah. He used to say that you do Islamic poetry all the time. Ki Muhammad se wafa toote to hum tere. So where is your wafa with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He said, why? He said, I don't see beard on your face. Don't you know that beard is sunnah muakkad and according to some fuqaha it is wajib? And every prophet used to have. So where is the beard on your face? So Allama Iqbal was a man of few words. He didn't used to debate. He just smiled. He used to smile and keep quiet. Okay, after a few days, the same guy came to Allama Iqbal and he said, you know, my parents passed away. Oh yes, yeah, I know that. May Allah forgive them. But you know, you are a big barrister. I need your help here. So what? I have a sister, I have sister. And my parents have left good amount of money behind. Tell me a way that legally I can deprive my sisters of their share. Legally. Now he's praying salah and all that. He's asking, but tell me how legally I can deprive my sisters of their share. So Allama Iqbal again smiled and he said something beautiful. He said, Mali sahab, ek kaam karte hain. Hum aap ek deal bana lete hain. Let's make a deal. And that deal is that you agree to give the share that your sister legally enjoy. Give them the share and I promise that I'll start growing beard. That person never came back. So that is this concept. So first in Mu'amalat, if this person is praying salat and all that stuff, fasting, that person is not going to be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And even if so, our Mu'amalat has to be right. So, yes, sir. Now Rasulullah said in one hadith Shri that every action of the son of Adam is giving manifold reward, each good deed receiving 10 times its life up to 700 times. Allah the Most High said, except for fasting, for it is for me and I will recompense for it. He leaves off his desire and his food for me. So how much reward you will get for fasting, Allah says, leave it to me. I will not give you any figure. Why? Because fasting is for me. So fasting, the reward, nobody knows. Allah said, no, I'm going to give. So brother, when a king says, I'll make you happy, don't worry. So a person is so hopeful. When the king will give according to his status. And you will ask according to your status. So Allah said, no, leave the fasting reward for me, I will give. Now, there was this guy, may Allah forgive him, he was a Jewish person, his name was Leopold Wiesel. He was from Austria. His name is Muhammad Asad. He passed away, I think most of you must have read about him. A remarkable person. His book, The Road to Makkah, he wrote, and that became the bestseller for many, many years. He lived in New York later on and then he passed away. He also did translation of Quran into English. Remarkable man. So, he said things about Ramadan. He talked about social responsibility, self-discipline, and Islamic ethics. So inshallah, you can read about it, but I will just read one of his saying here. He said, twofold, I learned is the purpose of fasting. One has to abstain from food and drink in order to feel in one's body what the poor and hungry feel. Thus, social responsibility is being hammered into religious consciousness as a religious posture. So he's saying that, you know, I like this as well. So inshallah, you can read this. I don't want to take much time on this. Of course, brothers, when you are fasting, you feel for hungry. And brother, especially this year, there's hunger everywhere. Everywhere there's hunger. So many Muslim countries, you know, just look at Burma, what's going on. You know, the plight of Burmese Muslims is not even talked about. People are dying there, literally of hunger and thirst. So this should make us feel for the hungry. When you are hungry, you should feel for the hungry people. Okay, as I said that in this month, this is the month of Quran. Quran was revealed. So the more we read Quran and listen to Quran, then inshallah it will be rewarding. Now the health benefits, which I don't want to indulge to, you can read it yourself, but we all agree that fasting is good for health, but that is a side benefit. You know, the real benefit is that Allah, we want forgiveness in the month of Ramadan. Now if these are the side benefits, inshallah, and all these things that different people have said different things, like the Dr. Goldstein has said a few things about fasting, which we find in Muslim, the literature now which are being published in US, they have quoted him, just right here. So these are all health benefits and the social benefits that come with Ramadan. Now the beliefs about fasting, that it hurts our body, it hurts us. Our belief is that no, it will not hurt you. Something Rasulullah ordered us to do, it is not going to hurt us. Okay? Fasting is all benefits. Inshallah, you will not be hurt, inshallah. Yeah. Any questions you can ask, inshallah. No. So I just wanted to keep myself to 45 minutes for this and 45 minutes for zakat. So now 45 minutes are up. Now, inshallah, we'll quickly turn to. Now one thing before I upload the zakat PowerPoint, and that is that inshallah in our masjid website, icorlando.org, we are starting a new feature this year, and that is Ramadan Helpline. What it does is that any question that you have about Ramadan, any mistake you made, any issue that came up, whatever, right? The zakat issues, Ramadan issues, fitra issues, fidya issues, Etikaf issues, Talabi issues, whatever the issues are, all simply have you do is that go on our website and click that help, Ramadan Helpline tab, and just post your question. And inshallah, I will give you answer within 24 hours.